Hello everyone. Today we are going to have a look at the history of Incas or Quechas in Peru, which was largest of the indigenous civilizations in South America. In the 12th century, the first Inca, Manco Capac, established his capital at Cusco. Expansion began under the 9th Inca, Pachacutec, and at its maximum extent, the Inca Empire stretched 3,000 miles from Ecuador to Chile. Their empire extended across western South America from Quito in the north to Santiago in the south. You may easily locate these places on the map here on the screen. 40,000 Incas governed a huge territory with some 10 million subjects speaking over 30 different languages. The empire was highly centralized, with the king representing the highest source of authority. Newly conquered tribes were absorbed effectively. Every subject was required to speak Quechua, the language of the court. Each tribe in the kingdom was ruled independently by a council of elders, but the tribe as a whole owed its allegiance to the ruler. At the same time, local rulers or chiefs were rewarded for their military cooperation. Thus, the Inca Empire resembled a confederacy. The Inca king was an absolute ruler, and he lived a life of great opulence, drinking from gold and silver cups, wearing silver shoes, and living in a palace furnished with the finest textiles. He was pampered to the extreme. King was even looked after following his death, as the Inca mummified their rulers. Stored in the Curiconcha temple in Cusco, the mummies were brought outside in elaborate ceremonies. They were also offered food and drink and consulted for their opinion on important state affairs. It also reflects Inca religious rituals also involved ancestor worship, as seen through the practice of mummification and making offerings to the god with food, drink, and precious materials. The Incas were magnificent builders. They built roads through mountains from Ecuador to Chile. Their forts were built of stone slabs that were so perfectly cut that they did not require mortar. They used labor-intensive technology to carve and move stones from nearby rock falls. As you can see in this image, masons shaped the blocks using an effective but simple method called flaking. Many stones weighed more than 100 metric tons, but they did not have any wheeled vehicles to transport these, so labor was organized and very tightly managed. Their spectacular adaptation of natural landscapes with terracing, highways, and mountaintop settlements continues to impress modern visitors at such world-famous sites as Machu Picchu. Before we proceed ahead, you may have a look at some of the structures built by the Incas. The basis of the Inca civilization was agriculture. To cope with the infertile soil conditions, they terraced hillsides and developed systems of drainage and irrigation. The Incas grew corn and potatoes and reared llamas for food and labor. Their weaving and pottery were of a high quality. Inca art is best seen in highly polished metalwork in gold, silver, and copper. Do you know, gold was considered as the sweat of the sun and silver was considered the tears of the moon. Inca art can also be witnessed in ceramics and textiles. Designs often use geometrical shapes and are technically accomplished and standardized. The checkerboard stands out as a very popular design. We need to mention that the works using precious metals such as discs, jewelry, figures, and everyday objects were made exclusively for Inca nobles, and even some textiles were restricted for their use alone. Goods made using the super soft vicuna wool were restricted, and only the Inca ruler could own vicuna herds. Ceramics were for wider use, and the most common shape was urpu, a bulbous vessel with a long neck and two small handles low on the pot, which was used for storing maize. For tax purposes, censuses were taken and populations divided up into groups based on multiples of 10. As there was no currency in the Inca world, taxes were paid in kind, usually foodstuffs, precious metals, textiles, exotic feathers, dyes, and spondylus shells, but also in laborers who could be shifted about the empire to be used where they were most needed. They did not develop a system of writing. However, there was an accounting system in place, the quipu or quarts, upon which notes were made to indicate specific mathematical units. Some scholars now suggest that the Incas wove a sort of code into these threads. Moving ahead with religion, Inca rulers made regular pilgrimages to Tiwanaku, where two shrines were built to the sun god Inti, who was considered as the supreme Inca deity, along with the moon goddess Mamakilia. Besides, religious ceremonies took place according to the astronomical calendar, especially the movements of the sun, moon and Milky Way or Mayu. Processions and ceremonies could also be connected to agriculture, especially the planting and harvesting seasons. Another sacred Inca site was Pachacama, a temple city built in honor of the god with the same name, who believed to have created humans, plants and was responsible for earthquakes. A large wooden statue of the god, considered an oracle, brought pilgrims from across the Andes to worship at Pachacama. As far as religious beliefs and rituals are concerned, sacrifices, both animals and humans, including children, were also made to pacify and honor the gods and ensure the good health of the king. As far as the society is concerned, it was hierarchical. But there was no private ownership of resources by a few people. However, priests and shamans were accorded an exalted status. Large temples were also built. Interestingly, in their culture, gold and silver were used, but there was no great value placed on gold or silver. It was considered as a regular metal. This is what attracted the people from foreign lands. Now, let's move on to the encounter of Incas with the Spaniards. People of Spain visited the native lands of Americas in the hope of exploring more land and resources. Pizarro is a significant name to mention here. Francisco Pizarro was a Spanish conquistador. Conquistador means he was a soldier and explorer. He is best known for his expeditions that led to the Spanish conquest of Peru. He had heard stories about the Inca kingdom as a land of silver and gold. When he met the Spanish king, he showed him beautifully designed gold jars of Inca workmanship. The king's greed was aroused and he promised Pizarro the governorship of the Inca lands if he conquered it. Pizarro got a chance in the year 1532. There was a civil war going on in Inca for succession to the throne. Atahualpa secured the throne of the Inca Empire after the civil war. But Pizarro arrived on the scene and captured the king after setting a trap for him. The king offered a room full of gold as ransom for his release, the most extravagant ransom recorded in history. But Pizarro did not honor his promise. The king was executed and Pizarro's followers went on a looting spree. This was followed by the occupation of the country. The cruelty of the conquerors provoked an uprising in the year 1534 that continued for 2 years, during which time thousands died in war and due to epidemics. In another 5 years, the Spanish had located the vast silver mines in Potosi, in Upper Peru, which is in modern-day Bolivia, and to work these, they made the Inca people into slaves. It was this combination of factors, a perfect storm of rebellion, disease, and invasion, which brought the downfall of the mighty Inca Empire, the largest and richest ever seen in the Americas. Today, the Inca language Quechua is still spoken by some 8 million people. There are also a good number of buildings, artifacts and written accounts which have survived the ravages of conquerors, looters and time. But surely, these remains are proportionally few to the vast riches which have been lost. But they remain indisputable witnesses to the wealth, ingenuity and high cultural achievements of this great but short-lived civilization. So this is all about Inca civilization. Do subscribe to Constructing Minds for more academic videos. And for regular updates, do hit the bell icon.